In the Old Testament, Jesus said, "All who hate me love death." Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Accepting him as your Lord and Savior and choosing to follow him puts you on the way. Obeying the truth of God's word keeps you on the way that ends in eternal life. Your eternal destiny will be determined by your choices in this world. Steps to Life exists to help people find the way, the truth, and the life.
To study for a few minutes about Christ's triumph for us and what it means to us in our personal living, our personal daily experience. His triumph for us is not just a story like people often use. It has a direct bearing on our own life and living and the kind of life we should live. And before we study, let's pray that the Lord will help us to understand what we're going to read. Father in heaven, we thank you that we still live in a country where we have freedom to assemble, to study your word together, to pray, to sing together, to worship you. And Lord, we know that these blessings that we have long enjoyed are one day soon going to be taken from us, and we pray that we will be ready for that time. Help us in this time of comparative peace, that we might be preparing, that we might be ready for what's ahead for this world. And for us individually, we pray that you'll be our teacher so that we might be prepared and ready for the final crisis that is coming in the world very soon. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Are you interested and paying attention to the things that heaven is interested in? When we study sacred history, we find that very often the things that heaven is most interested in, people in this world aren't paying any attention to. They don't even know that it's happening. And I want to read to you in the Gospel of Luke, perhaps the most primary or outstanding example of this happening. If you look in Luke, the second chapter, it says, starting in verse 8, "There were in the same country shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night." Now, we didn't read the first seven verses. If you read the first seven verses, you will see it's talking about the birth of Jesus Christ in the manger in Bethlehem, the first seven verses of this chapter. And it says, In that same country, that same night when Jesus was born, there were shepherds living out in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. "And behold, an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were greatly afraid. Then the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which will be to all people. For there is born to you this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord.'" And then he said, "And this will be the sign to you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, 'Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men.'" The plains of Bethlehem were illuminated with the brilliant glory of a multitude. It says here, there was a multitude of the heavenly hosts. We don't know how many, but there was a multitude of angels that they saw. Ellen White indicates this was the brightest vision that any human being had seen since the fall of mankind. But the shepherds weren't the only ones that saw this. Ellen White makes it very plain in her writings that there was somebody else that was watching. is somebody else that was watching, was the great rebel chief. He saw, the devil was there watching, and he saw the amazement of the shepherds as they beheld the illuminated plains. And he saw the shepherds tremble, but he was trembling himself. Why was he trembling? Because he heard the angel say, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." City of David, of course, is Bethlehem. That was David's hometown, home city. Now the devil at this time, for 4,000 years, he had met with very good success in devising plans to ruin mankind. The result was that he had become bold in his machinations and powerful. Here's how Ellen White describes it. She says, he had controlled the minds and bodies of men from Adam down to the first appearing of Christ. He had controlled the minds and bodies of men. But now, he was alarmed. What was he alarmed for? Well, he was alarmed for his kingdom and his life. Because the devil had studied ancient prophecy. He knew it was predicted that the Son of the Highest was going to come to this world and effect a redemption plan to redeem mankind, and that he was going to set up a kingdom in this world that would eventually encompass all nations of the earth. And he knew that this didn't mean any good for him, because he had an opposite type of a kingdom. The devil has a kingdom, you know. His kingdom is called the kingdom of darkness. Now, every kingdom, of course, you can't have a kingdom without having a law. In God's kingdom, there is a law. In fact, that law is the foundation of his government. We should maybe just read that in the Bible. You look back in the book of Psalms, Psalm 89, good starting place. Psalm 89, verse 14 and 15. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face. Blessed are the people who know the joyful sound. So it says here that righteousness and judgment is the foundation of God's throne. It says the same thing in Psalm 97. Psalm 97, verse 2. It says, clouds and darkness around him, righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. Okay, so righteousness and justice are the foundation of his throne. What is righteousness? Look in your Bible in Psalm 119, 172. My tongue shall speak of your word, for all your commandments are righteousness. All his commandments are righteousness, and righteousness is the foundation of his throne. And in the earthly sanctuary, you all know that in the most holy place, right underneath the cherubim, in the Ark of the Covenant, right at the base, where God dwelt, that's where his law was. God has a law. All those who are the subject of his kingdom are subject to that law and obedient to that law. You cannot be a subject of Christ's kingdom if you are not subject to his law and obedient to that law. Jesus himself said, I was obedient to my Father's commandments. And he said, if you love me, keep my commandments. And the Apostle John, who wrote those words, also wrote in 1 John 5, this is the love of God, that you keep his commandments. So, if you're a subject of God's kingdom, you're subject to His commandments. Satan also has a kingdom. It's the kingdom of darkness. And he has a law in his kingdom too. And let's read in the Bible what the law is in Satan's kingdom. Look in 1 John 3. Verse 8. He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Notice, the devil has a law. And what is the devil's law? What must you do to be a loyal, faithful subject in the devil's kingdom of darkness? You must break God's law. That is the law of the devil's kingdom. And the devil is working 24 hours a day, 365 days a year, all over the world to try to persuade, seduce, deceive, or force, or in any way to make every human being in the world break God's law. That's the devil's objective. That's what Adventists talk a lot. When we preach the three angels' message, we talk about the mark of the beast and the image of the beast and all those things. And what is that all about? What's the mark of the beast about? It's an effort to force people or persuade people to break God's law. And God's law is one. There's 10 commandments, but the 10 commandments is only one law. So any one of the 10 commandments that you break makes you a lawbreaker and makes you a member of the devil's kingdom, a subject of the devil's kingdom, and the whole universe can see it. And James talks about this very specifically in James' second chapter. He says, the same person who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not kill. So if you kill, but you don't commit adultery, you're a breaker of the law. You don't have to break all 10. If you break one, you're a breaker of the law. And that is the law of the devil's kingdom. And the devil is trying to establish throughout this world a kingdom of darkness where every single person is in one way or another induced, deceived, cajoled, or forced to break the law of God. When I have studied the customs of ancient heathen nations, I've been appalled at what they have done. Why did the devil have them offering child sacrifices? In Babylon, why was it the custom of that land that every woman had at least once to go to the temple of the sun god and consort with a male prostitute in that? Why was that a custom? Because that would bring that person under the condemnation of God's law. They'd broken one of the commandments. Idolatry, the same thing. Nebuchadnezzar was going to, under the devil's direction, he was going to have everybody in the world break God's law by making an image, and then you're going to bow down to it. That's still the devil's plan. His plan has been the same since the beginning. To induce every single, or induce, persuade, deceive, or force some way every single human being in the world to break God's law. And he'd been very successful. But when he saw these angels say to the shepherds, we're bringing you good news, a great joy that it's going to be to all the people of the world. There's born to you today, this night, in the city of David, a Savior who is Christ the Lord. The devil knew what that meant. That meant that somebody was going to come that was going to save the people of this world from him. He knew that didn't mean any good for him. By the way, it is true today. Remember, I just read to you, Ellen White said that he had controlled the minds and bodies of men from Adam down to the first appearing of Christ. And my dear friends, it's true today. You and I are not independent. People think they're independent. They talk about independent, but they're not. Every human being in the world is being influenced by supernatural powers, and you're either yielding your mind to the control of the Holy Spirit, or if you don't, the devil is going to have control of your mind. Ellen White makes some very interesting statements about this. She says the people whose minds are under the control of the devil will tell you that they're doing as they please. They can do anything they want, and they're in control of their life. Just, they're not in control. They don't know. They're being influenced by evil angels. They don't know it. Look in the book Testimonies to Ministers, page 79. He says, every mind that is not under the control of God is under the control of Satan or evil angels. So, the advent of our Savior to this fallen world, the joy that was expressed. Here's a multitude of angels praising God for the wonderful news. The devil knew that didn't mean anything good for him. He had dark forebodings that started developing in his mind. What was going to happen to him and to his kingdom? He asked himself the question. He had studied prophecy, you know. Is this the one that is predicted in ancient prophecies that will come to this world and establish a kingdom that will eventually control all the kingdoms of the world? And so, Ellen White says that from the very birth of Christ, Satan began to look at this person as his rival, and he was stirred up with feelings of envy and jealousy. He well remembered who it was that had driven him, expelled him from heaven. It was Jesus Christ and the loyal angels that expelled him from heaven. He well remembered that. And he decided to thwart God's plan. What he would do, he would destroy. He wouldn't just destroy Christ. He'd destroy all little babies anywhere around in Bethlehem, destroy them all. And Ellen White says that he was the one that stirred up the heart of Herod with jealousy and envy that there's a king that's been born, and if you don't destroy this person is going to take away your throne and your kingdom. Herod was a very wicked man. Sent out armies, soldiers into Bethlehem, and they took the babies right out of the mother's arms and took the sword that killed them. Right in front of their bank. It was awful. One of the most awful crimes recorded in the Bible. The devil was trying to destroy Christ at his very birth. But he saw, in the midst of all his efforts, there was another power working that was thwarting his plans. Because before he was able to bring that into effect, an angel of God warned Joseph and said, look, you get up right by night. You get up right now. You get Mary and the child Jesus, and you take him flee into the land of Egypt because Herod is going to seek to destroy the child. And by the time the soldiers came, Joseph and Mary and Jesus were a long ways away from Bethlehem on their way to Egypt. But Satan didn't quit. Satan followed Jesus Christ from his infancy to his childhood, and from his childhood to manhood. Sometimes people talk to me about the way that they're tempted, and I understand people are tempted. But my dear friends, none of us have ever been tempted to the extent and with the constancy that Jesus Christ was tempted. Because Satan made him the focal point of all the evil angels of hell to attack, to some way overcome. What was his goal? Well, he had caused every other person in the world to sin. And so what he had to do was figure out a way to some way get Jesus as a child, to be impatient, or to get angry, or to complain. Do you realize that if he had been successful in doing that, just one time, the plan of salvation would have been lost. We would have been lost. Why was that? Well, let me explain that just a minute. Everyone in the world was defiled by sin. Jesus had come to pay the price of the sins of this world. Jesus had told the angels that not one of them could do it. He was the only one that could do it. But in order for that to happen, have you studied the sacrificial system under Moses? Have you studied that in the Old Testament and Leviticus? Have you noticed that God specified that a sacrifice had to be perfect? Have you noticed that? They could not bring an animal that had any imperfection. Why was that? In order to be successful, to pay the price of the sins of the world, Christ had to be able to offer himself as an unblemished sacrifice. The devil knew that. And so the devil's goal all the time that Jesus was growing up, some way, trick him, some way, get him. And when you read in Desire of Ages about the years of his childhood, it blows your mind that even his mother did not understand. His brothers, his so-called brothers, they were the sons of Joseph, they persuaded Mary to try to convince and persuade Jesus to be a little bit more charitable with the religious leaders and not. Well, when that happened, Jesus said, well, show me from the Bible. They couldn't show him. And as Jesus got older, year after year went by, the devil's trying everything imaginable to taint him so that he wouldn't be a perfect sacrifice, destroy the plan of salvation. He's bringing every kind of subtle temptation that has worked with everybody else. And the fact that he was not being successful annoyed him exceedingly. Ellen White says, all his darts and arrows of temptation fell harmless before the Son of God. And when he found that all his temptations prevailed nothing in moving Christ from the steadfast integrity or marring the spotless purity of the youthful Galilean, he was perplexed and enraged. The devil was perplexed, but he was also enraged. The idea, the fact that there was one person in the world who had the moral power to withstand every temptation that he could bring against him and resist all of his bribes to be alerted to sin. He couldn't seem to gain any advantage over Christ, and it made him enraged. The time came when the devil watched the development of the work of John the Baptist. And he saw that this was a man that he couldn't move from his integrity, and he was telling the people to prepare the way of the Lord and make his path straight, and something that John the Baptist did. Anybody that's preaching or teaching needs to pray that the Lord will help you to do this today, because we have the same problem. John the Baptist caused people to understand the exceeding sinfulness of sin. Now, friends, I'm not trying to point a finger at anybody. But I've been around a little bit, preached to congregations in various parts of the country, and I can tell you this for a fact. Many, I don't want to say most, I hope it's not most, many Adventists do not understand the exceeding sinfulness of sin. When John the Baptist preached, the exceeding sinfulness of sin was revealed to people in such a manner that people became alarmed. Let me ask you something. If there is any sin in your life, is that sin causing you to become alarmed? This bothers me. Because I see people, they're struggling, but there's a sin in their life, and they're not alarmed. Ellen White writes in the book Great Controversy concerning the early church in the first centuries, she said, their doctrines were a terror to evildoers. Are the doctrines that you believe a terror to evildoers? And when John the Baptist preached, the exceeding sinfulness of sin was revealed so that men became alarmed. And when they became alarmed, there were people that started to pray and said, Lord, save me from this. And there were people that went to the Lord and they repented and they left their life of sin. In fact, Jesus talked about it himself. There were tax collectors and harlots, the people that were considered the worst people in society that came and listened to John the Baptist preach and repented and were baptized and started to live a different life. And by the way, it was from among these people that the earliest followers of Jesus came. There's a reason for that. The ministry of John the Baptist had to come first before the Messiah could come and be successful. That's something we're not going to study right now. The time came when John was down there at the Jordan River baptizing that Jesus himself came to be baptized. Ellen White says that the devil was there and he was watching this too because he'd been following Jesus for 30 years trying to figure out some way to bribe him into sin, to trick him into sin, to do something. And he hadn't been successful. He's been so frustrated, become enraged, that he'd never had this problem with any other human being. Here's what Ellen White says about it. He says, he was on the ground at the time when Christ presented himself to John for baptism. He heard the majestic voice resounding through heaven and echoing through the earth like peals of thunder. He saw the lightnings flash from the cloudless heavens and heard the fearful words from Jehovah. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. He saw the brightness of the Father's glory overshadowing the form of Jesus, thus pointing out in that crowd the one whom he acknowledged as his Son with unmistakable assurance. The circumstances connected with this baptismal scene aroused the most intense hatred in the breast of Satan. He knew then for a certainty that unless he could overcome Christ, from thenceforth there would be a limitation of his power. And so, you see, from the beginning when Satan had led man into sin, what he was hoping is, and you wonder, why was Satan trying to degrade the human race all the time? And here's the reason. He hoped that God's abhorrence of sin would cause him to completely separate himself from such a wicked bunch of people. He wanted to cause a permanent break in the link between earth and heaven. It looked like he was being successful, but here, there's a voice right from the throne of God concerning a human being, not an angel, a human being. God says, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. When the devil heard that, that was just like somebody pronouncing his death sentence. Because he knew that if Christ should succeed in this, that eventually his power would be curtailed and eventually he would be called to account for all he had done. He would lose his kingdom and his power. And he was afraid that God was somewhere going to unite man more closely with himself, to give him power to overcome the devil's his devices. And of course, Satan was very well acquainted with the position that Christ had held in heaven. He knew that he was the Son of God, the beloved of the Father. And the idea that he would leave heaven and that he would come to this world as a man filled him with apprehension for his safety. And he couldn't comprehend the mystery of the great sacrifice, why the Son of God would be willing to do such a thing. He knew. He knew what you and I do not know. He knew that the value of heaven far exceeded the appreciation and anticipation of fallen man. He knew that the most costly treasures of earth could not be compared with the glories of heaven, the worth of heaven. He knew what he had lost. Because of his rebellion, he had lost all the riches and the pure glories of heaven that he had previously enjoyed. And he was determined that he was going to be revenged upon God for casting him out of heaven. He was going to try to cause as many people of the human race to be lost as possible so that he could be revenged upon the God of heaven who had designed a plan for their salvation. And how does he come to human beings to cause them to be lost? Actually, when you think it through, he comes to us in the same ways that he came to Jesus in the wilderness. You see, I have this little book, Confrontation, here, but I don't think that we will take time to read very many statements out of it. He goes into there are three main ways that the devil comes to the human family, and all branches of evil come out from one of these three ways. And what are those three ways? Well, the first way is the way he came to Jesus with the first temptation. That was the temptation. I call it the sensual temptation. We sometimes say the temptation and appetite, yes? Temptation and appetite, but included with appetite are all manner of sensual temptations to gratify the cravings of the body. Does the body develop cravings? I remember reading the story of a man who was interred in a concentration camp, in a communist concentration camp, because he was a pastor. And they stood him in front of a white wall with light on it and forced him to just stand there. Didn't give him anything to eat, didn't give him anything to drink for days. And he had guards on both sides. He was describing this experience in the book I was reading, and he said, "I developed such a great thirst that even now, whenever I think about it, I have to go to the kitchen and get a drink of water." He said the thirst was worse than hunger, tiredness, anything else. The thirst was just about driving him insane. Jesus was in the wilderness, suffering hunger and thirst 40 days. What was this for? Let me read just one quick statement about this in this little book, Confrontation. Although, this is page 64, although Christ gained a priceless victory in behalf of man in overcoming the temptations of Satan in the wilderness, this victory will not benefit him unless he also gains the victory on his own account. The victory of Christ over the devil in the wilderness on the point of appetite, a central temptation, that won't do me any good Unless what? Unless I gain the victory on the same temptation. You get it? Christ's victory will not do me any good unless I gain the same victory on my own behalf. He gained the victory for me so that I could gain the victory through His power and strength on my own behalf. If I don't gain the victory, what did she say? If I don't gain the victory, His victory won't do me any good. I'll read it again. This victory will not benefit him unless he also gains the victory on his own account. You and I are to gain the victory on these three temptations, just like Jesus did. Please, friend, I'm not here to threaten anybody. I'm not here to scare anybody. But we're living so near the end of time. Don't you think it's time to think seriously and to recognize that if we want to be in the kingdom of heaven, we have to gain the victory on these three things just like Jesus did. And the second temptation, of course, is on the point of presumption. Presumption is a very common and very successful temptation. In fact, I was surprised some years ago when I was studying about this. You know, Satan is successful with the majority of the human race on sensual temptations, appetites and passions. He's successful in getting people to break the law of God. Let's be real simple, plain. If I eat in either too much or in a character of food that is going to damage my body, am I breaking the law of God? Yes, I am. Breaking the sixth commandment, for one thing. So the devil gains the victory in the majority of the human race with sensual temptations alone. But the devil has more than one weapon to use on you. If the devil doesn't gain the victory over you with a sensual temptation, he's got another one that's really powerful. You know how powerful it is? Ellen White says that when the devil comes to men and women with a temptation of presumption, that's presuming on God's mercy. Millions of people will lose their soul over this. And they're presuming on God's mercy. She says when the devil comes to men and women with this temptation, he wins the victory. The devil wins the victory 9 times out of 10. That just scared me when I read it. So the devil comes to people with sensual temptations, and that gains the victory over the majority. But if that doesn't work, he's going to come to you with a temptation on presumption. I can never claim that I haven't been victim to the temptation of presumption. I pray about this. I realized when I was a little over 20 years old, I had very serious presumptions. I had a lot of praying to do. Well, if he doesn't gain the victory over you with either of those two, he has a third one. And what is that? It is to some way entice you so that you love something, and he doesn't care what it is, so that you love something in this world more than you love the Father, your Father in heaven. Remember, the whole law of God can be summed up in 2 points, Jesus said. The first great commandment is you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind. And the second is like it, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. If the devil can get you to fix your affections on either yourself or something in this world. I remember visiting family in another state. And the mother was talking to me about her daughter-in-law. And she said she was very fearful for her daughter-in-law. I thought, well, why is that? I thought your daughter-in-law was a nice person. Well, she said, my daughter-in-law loves my son so much that I'm fearful for her soul's salvation. Can you love your husband or your wife so much that you love that person more than the God of heaven? Did Jesus say anything about this? You remember what Jesus said in Matthew 10? If somebody loves their son or daughter or father or mother more than me, then what? Not worthy of me. I said, well, I can't do anything about that. I can't talk to your daughter-in-law about it. All I can do is pray. And your daughter-in-law won't love your son more than she loves the God of heaven. Ellen White says that all branches of evil flow out from these three temptations, three types of temptations. The devil, of course, since he had been developing a selfish character for at least 4,000 years at this time, couldn't understand how God would love the human race so much that he would be willing to come to this world as a man. Because he knew what Jesus had given up in order to come here. The devil had experienced the pure contentment, the peace, exalted holiness, and unalloyed joys of the heavenly abode. That's what Ellen White says. He had realized before his rebellion the satisfaction of the full approval of God. He had once a full appreciation of the glory that enshrouded the Father and knew that there was no limit to his power. He knew what he was had lost already, and now he was afraid that the kingdom of darkness that he controlled in this world was going to be contested. And his fear was exactly what was going to happen, because his kingdom was going to be contested. He was afraid that his right would be disputed, and that's exactly what was going to happen. He was afraid that his power would be broken, and that's exactly what was going to happen. Now, he knew that it was predicted in ancient prophecy that a Savior was going to come to this world. He knew from ancient prophecy that the Savior's kingdom would not be established in earthly triumph and with worldly honor and display. He knew that the ancient prophecies predicted that the Prince of Heaven was going to come to this world and establish a kingdom that he claimed as his dominion, and that this kingdom would eventually encompass all the nations of the earth. And then he knew when that happened that his power and his glory would cease, and he would receive his retribution for the sins he had introduced into the world and for the misery that he had caused to the human race. So he knew that everything depended upon his winning over Christ. So he came to Jesus with the power of temptation that you and I actually cannot understand. Ellen White says that it is impossible for the human mind to comprehend the severity of the temptations that Jesus suffered. He was made the focal point of all the intelligences and weapons of hell. He says it is impossible for man to know the strength of Satan's temptations to the Son of God. Every temptation that seems so afflicting to man in his daily life, so difficult to resist and overcome, was brought to bear upon the Son of God in as much greater degree as his excellence of character was superior to that of fallen man. If you want to read, now we don't have time to do that now, but if you want to read, Ellen White gives a description of these temptations and what the devil actually said to Jesus and how he taunted him and how he tried to trick him. It's all in this little book, A Confrontation. Said several pages of reading. So she describes what the devil said and how he tried to trick Jesus into falling into sin, or how he tried to bribe him. And the first temptation was terrible. The second temptation was terrible. But the third temptation, to my mind, was by far the worst. And Ellen White says it was the most alluring of the three. Let me describe very briefly why this third temptation was so terrible. did the devil know that in order to redeem the human race, that the Son of God was going to have to offer his life as an unblemished sacrifice to pay for the sins of man? Did the devil know that? Yes, he did. Did Jesus know that? Yes, he did. Jesus knew that at the beginning, this was at the beginning of his ministry, he knew that he was walking up, that for the next 3 years he was going to walk up a narrow road that would become more and more bloodstained. He knew that at the end, he knew all about what he was going to suffer at the hands of the Jews. You can read about it in Matthew 16, Matthew 17. He started telling the disciples about a year before it happened. He started trying to prepare the disciples. He said, look, he says, we're going to go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the chief priests and elders. And they're going to condemn him and scourge him and crucify him. And then the third day he will rise again. That's when, you remember, that's when Peter began to rebuke him. He said, oh, Lord, this is not going to happen to you. Yes, it's going to happen. Jesus knew the path that he was going. He knew that in fulfilling the will of God to save the human race, that he was going to suffer inexpressible, superhuman agony. And by the way, please remember that the agony that Jesus suffered was not so much being nailed to a cross. You've read in Desire of Ages, he says the physical pain was hardly felt because of what? Because of the mental agony that he suffered when he had the sins of the entire world. By the way, let me explain something here quickly. To God, the distant past and the distant future are all the same. God knows everything about every detail about the distant past. He knows every detail about the distant future. God knew about you and about me at that time. And all the sins that ever had been or ever would be committed, they were gathered together and they were placed upon Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. And caused, in fact, Ellen White says that no human being could have stood this. The only reason that Christ could even endure it is because he was both human and divine. And because of his divinity, he could stand more suffering than a human being could suffer without dying. I can't explain or understand that. And his mental suffering when your sins and my sins were placed upon him on the cross of Calvary was so great. How could you suffer mental suffering that would be so great that you could be nailed to a cross and the physical pains hardly felt? I can't explain that. Did Jesus know about that when he was tempted by the devil in the wilderness? He most certainly did. The devil knew about it too. The devil came to him with a proposition. It says in both Luke and Matthew, in a moment of time, he showed him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them. And he said, look, you don't have to go to the cross. You don't have to go through all that awful suffering. If you just kneel before me and undo me homage as a superior, I'll give it all to you right now. You don't have to suffer. I don't think it's possible. I'm not trying to insult you. I'm better speaking first person. I'll just say, I know it's impossible for me to even comprehend the power of a temptation like that. Knowing what Jesus knew. Knowing what the devil says, you don't have to suffer. Have you ever gone to the Lord and said, Lord, I don't want to suffer? You ever done that? If Jesus had decided, I don't want to suffer, you and I would not be saved. He was willing to suffer. He turned away. He said, no. He was willing to walk up the bloodstained path all the way to Calvary. to fulfill the plan of salvation. As man's representative, he stood the closest test. He met the strongest force of Satan. He has tested and he has conquered on behalf of man. And you may think you're the weakest person or you're the most sinful person. And it is true, by the way. There are some people that are weaker than others. There are some people that have a worse heredity than others. Ellen White's very clear about this. There are some people for whom it is more difficult to overcome than for others. She acknowledges that. But my dear friend, no matter how bad your heredity is, no matter how checkered your past life has been, Desire of Ages, page 671, Ellen White writes that God has given His Spirit as a divine power to enable man to overcome every hereditary and cultivated tendency to evil. Friend, that's God's promise. If anybody could come to the judgment and say, Lord, I surrendered everything to you, and I could not bear it. If anybody could really say that and tell the truth, it would destroy the government of God, because God has promised, if you give yourself to me, no temptation is going to come to you. But what? I will be with you and enable you to bear it. I'll make a way of escape so that you can bear it. Isn't that a most wonderful promise that you can take security in? Is anybody here and you're struggling and you're saying, Lord, how am I going to do? What am I going to do? Remember, friend, you have an all-powerful mediator who is able to keep you, to sustain you, and to give you the victory over any temptation that God allows to come to you. Let's pray that this text, 1 Corinthians 10:13, may be fulfilled in our life. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we give you thanks that we have an all-powerful mediator, and that if we put our dependence and trust in Him, that in every time of temptation, when things are happening that we ourselves are not equal to, that you will impart to us the grace, the power, so that we can endure, so that we can overcome, so that we do not need to keep falling into temptation and being dupes of the devil who is tricked or seduced or forced into sin. We thank you that you have made a way of escape so that we may endure and that we may conquer and render perfect obedience to your law. And we pray that this great miracle may be worked out in each of our lives as we are seeking to develop a pure character, a perfect character to honor and glorify our Redeemer. We pray in His name. Amen.
We hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. We would love to hear from you. Our mailing address is Steps to Life, P.O. Box 782-828, Wichita, Kansas 67278. You may call us at 1-800-THE-TRUTH. That's 1-800-843-8788. Our email address is historic@stepstolife.org, and our web address is www.stepstolife.org. May God be with you as you seek to walk the narrow way.